On Story is brought to you in part by the Alice Clayburgh Reynolds Foundation, a Texas family providing innovative funding since 1979. Festival, a look inside the creative process from today's leading writers and directors. This week's On Story, a conversation with writer, director, and actor James Franco.
I think it's a director's medium. When I'm on a set, I'm now pretty sure it's a director that I believe in, that I can trust and believe in his or her vision. And what I'm trying to do as an actor is help him or her achieve their vision, and that's it. You know, it's not about showing all the research I've done, preparation I've done. It's about helping them tell that story.
This episode, James Franco discusses the creative process behind his work on Danny Boyle's film, 127 Hours.
With 127 Hours, which was just so brilliant, James, it was such incredible performance. Was that script? Was it the story that inspired you? Was it, you know, Danny Boyle's interpretation?
Well, I can talk about that script. I mean, that was I think that whole movie was a puzzle to figure out every step of the way. So, Danny Boyle had read about Aaron Ralston when he was, you know, when he first got out of the canyon, and approached Aaron about doing a movie back then. I think it was like 5 or more years before we eventually made our film. And Aaron at that time was very interested in making a documentary style movie that he would be in. So I imagine there would be him giving interviews and then reenactments. But Aaron would, you know, thought he would play the part, and Danny just, you know, wasn't interested in that. It would be more along the lines of Touching the Void, if anyone knows that documentary. Great documentary. Right. But Danny didn't want to do that with this piece, and especially didn't want to have Aaron do the reenactments, because even though he had gone through the experience himself, we like to think that there are some things that actors bring. Mainly, they're able to convey emotions to an audience that even, you know, somebody that's been through an experience can tell you about, but maybe can't tell you emotionally about it through a performance. So he didn't want to do that. 5 years later or so, Danny had won the Oscar for Slumdog Millionaire, and Aaron hadn't made his documentary yet. So they got back together, and Aaron was now willing to listen to Danny's ideas. But nobody else, his screenwriter, Simon Pufoy, is that his name?
Yeah,
from Slumdog, didn't think it could be done. And he didn't want to write it. He didn't want to do it with Danny. He said, this is an impossible project. Not only because so much of it would involve a single performer in a confined space, but on top of that, Danny's approach was to make it even more isolated than maybe Aaron's account of it in his book. So if you adapted Aaron's book, you could have stuff before, his climbing trips before, and you see him, you know, a wild and reckless climber, you know, climbing all the peaks in Colorado, and then you could have the incident, but then you could have this, you know, alternate kind of scenario of the family wondering where he is, and working up, you know, the rescue mission and the helicopters looking for them. So there was a way to kind of cut away from Aaron's story if you wanted to, that you'd think that's maybe the way to go. That will pull us out of that maybe uncinematic scenario of a guy alone. But Danny didn't want to do that. He thought we should, you know, he should give the audience the experience of being trapped in that canyon with that character. So there are, that being said, there are times when he cuts away. Just if you look at the, you know, if you're just thinking about the structure of the film, he'll cut away to flashbacks or hallucinations, and that does give a little bit of what I'm talking about, this respite from the isolation. But even in those, if you watch closely, I didn't perform in any of those sequences. It's just, it's usually from my character's point of view, and maybe you'll see a hand or maybe a body, but it's not me. Danny was very clear in his own head that even though the movie would be going to flashbacks, the character wouldn't be able to escape. You wouldn't see him ever out of that canyon. And then what started happening is because he shot it that way, he could have me in the canyon having a dialogue with the people in the hallucination. So the ex-girlfriend, you know, is sort of talking in my hallucination or memory.
You know.
I told you, I'd have to kill you.
But already you kill me.
I think finally what convinced Simon that it could be done was the idea of the video camera and talking to the video camera, both something that Aaron actually did, which was great, you know, just a great gift to Danny and all of us. And it's also a great storyteller's tool, because there you can have a character talking about the most intimate side of himself, his most intimate feelings, talking ostensibly to his family and friends, thinking he's going to die, and talking directly to this camera. But then what's shown in the actual movie in the theater is this character looking directly out at the audience. So it's almost as if he's talking, it's like an aside, like a Shakespearean aside, and he's talking directly to the audience, even though you have it's justified by the fact that he's talking to his family.
My name's Aaron Ralston. My parents are Donna and Larry Ralston of Englewood, Colorado. Whoever finds this can keep the recorder. Just please try and get in touch with my parents and give them this tape. I'd appreciate it.
It creates an even more sort of intimate space between audience and performer just by the structure and the tools that he's using, in addition to the way that he shot it. You know, it's all up in my, you see, I mean, you don't get away from my face in that movie. So you, as an audience member, I mean, people would tell me, like, after coming out of that screening, and by the way, people did pass out in every screening I went to. So there was something psychosomatic. I mean, it was so intense. There was something happening and again and again and again that, you know, it just had, I mean, whatever you think of the movie, you can't deny that it had some power over, you know, certain people because they were passing out. But people would come out and tell me, like, it felt like an action movie. It felt like I went on a ride, but it doesn't, there's no big, you know, kind of action sequence, really. It's just, you're just there with the guy. But it's because I think once the character gets trapped, everybody knows what's going to happen. So once he's trapped, it's like the audience is trapped in there, yes, in that box with him.
Yep.
And you're just waiting for that arm to come off. And it just, the pressure just builds and builds and builds and builds. So we did two. They did two things. They built the set on a stage. They went and like lasered the actual canyon and got a perfect replica of that spot. And they built it to scale. And then, so we shot most of it on there in a stage in Salt Lake City. And then we went to the actual location outside of Moab for a couple weeks. Because it would just be too impossible to shoot the whole movie in that spot. Because when we did those 2 weeks, the crew was being helicoptered out there every day. We had to, like, do climbing to get to the, you know, certain spots in that location. So it was just, like, 3 hours of just getting to the spot every morning to just shoot, you know, shoot there when we were on location. So there's no way to do the whole thing there. We shot in pretty much in order. And what I meant, you know, by the figuring out the puzzle each step of the way is Danny was open. He knew, I guess he was smart enough to kind of leave some things unanswered beforehand that, so that they could be found on set. Early on in the scene where the character gets trapped, I try to just pull my arm out with brute strength, and so all these steps were, you know, scripted, you know, but there's not a lot of dialogue. It's just a lot of description. He gets trapped. He tries to pull his arm out, da da da, and so on that take, Danny said, all right, I want you to try and pull the arm out. Do everything you can. You kick, yank, you know, bash yourself against the rock. Do whatever you can to get it out, but you won't get it out. And then don't stop until I say cut. And I said, all right, that's fine. You know, I'm going to get beat up and bruised if I really do that. And he's like, yeah, I know you will. I said, okay, okay. And I said, okay, well, I hope you get it in the first take, because I don't know how many I can do. And he's like, all right, just don't stop. He said cut. I guess it was like it had been 21 minutes and of doing that. I was like exhausted, and I wish I got better pictures, because by the end of that movie I was all bruised, and he even had me like cutting out my arm a little bit, not with any sharp blades, but like, you know, I had bruises all over. And but what we found after that 21 minute take was, with a movie like this, where so much of it is based on behavior and these little peaks and valleys of, you know, minor accomplishments up leading up to the major escape accomplishment, that it would be too taxing and maybe deliver a less naturalistic result if we tried to just set up every little moment and have the camera set up. Okay, do this next moment. Reset. All right, do this next moment. Okay, you're 1 minute into trying to pull it out. It was, I think, an interesting approach for everyone, because it wasn't just a new experience for me acting, you know, most of my scenes alone. That's new for the DPs. Like, how do you cover a scene with only one person? It was new for the director. Like, usually, you know, you go and talk to the actors and you talk about what the conflict is or the situation, and, you know, bring that to life. Like, when you have one actor, what ended up happening is, like, Danny and the DPs almost became the performers opposite me. It's like he had it all there, and he has a performance of a guy getting progressively tired and frustrated. And so that's how we learned to do most of the behavioral scenes, just go and really do it. By doing that 21 minute take and then long takes in the other scenes after that, it was like, you know, I got water and wasn't there trapped for 5 days, but I guess I did it over the course of 2 months too. So in its own way, that's draining as well. But it's like I went through the footsteps that Aaron went through and had my own experience, rather than working from the outside saying, okay, he's supposed to be upset here or whatever. Like, just finding those moments in a more organic way, I think helped with that performance.
Hi, my name is Martin Rosete, and I'm the director of voiceover. I was looking for a very challenging story to direct, so when I read the script of voiceover written by Luis Overdejo, I instantly fell in love with it, and I thought that it was perfect. It was just the story that I was looking for. I was aware that for such a powerful script, we needed a very strong and spectacular image. And in that sense, I'm very happy and proud that we got to put together everything that I had in my mind before going to set to shoot voiceover. And we got that just because we got the best international cast and crew available in Spain. The feedback that we are getting for the audience is amazing. They are telling us that they are feeling basically the same agony that our character is living in the three situations. And they are almost feeling relief when they get the end. I cannot tell you how it ends, obviously, but I feel and I hope that you get the same relief. Coming up is my short film voiceover. Thanks for watching.
Spatiale s'est écrasée sur une planète qui t'est inconnue. J'espère seulement qu'elle appartient au système vers lequel tu te dirigeais. En entrant dans l'atmosphère, la navette s'est désintégrée. Et toi, éjecté avec ton siège, tu t'es retrouvé à plusieurs milles à l'ouest. Sur les 3 heures d'autonomie en oxygène que t'offre ta combinaison, il ne te reste que 3 minutes et 33 secondes. C'est le temps que tu as pour arriver jusqu'à une capsule qui a été éjectée de la navette peu de temps avant toi. Vérifier le bon état des réservoirs d'oxygène, envoyer la balise de position et attendre que quelqu'un vienne te chercher avant que ton oxygène ne s'achève, en supposant qu'il y en ait. Ah, rappelle-toi avant de te réveiller, il y a cette chose qui est entrée dans ta combinaison. Tu essayes de ne pas donner d'importance à la bestiole. Bien qu'il y ait à peine quelques minutes, tu as failli crier quand elle est entrée dans tes sous-vêtements. Et que tu as senti son corps froid et gluant bouger entre tes couilles. Tu n'as pas intérêt à perdre ton calme, sinon tu vas consommer plus d'air. En ce moment, il te reste 2 minutes et 33 secondes d'oxygène. Non, 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 merde! Je crois que je me suis trompé. En réalité, tu n'es pas sur cette planète. Tu es en France pendant la Première Guerre mondiale. Oui, c'est ça. Tu fais partie d'un petit peloton de 3 artificiers.
Non !
Tu sais que tu es le plus malin, mais aussi que les autres ont plus de couilles que toi. Il y a quelques heures, vous avez placé plusieurs charges de dynamite comme convenu sur la voie ferrée. Tu es allé te mettre à couvert de façon à activer les bombes. Et en même temps, cet idiot de Guillaume a marché sur une mine qui les a tués, lui et Claude. Et t'a laissé toi, sans jambes. Si tu veux crier, je le comprendrai. Réagis à présent. À Avec ce que tu perds comme sang, tu perdras conscience dans 1 minute et 33 secondes. 3 minutes après, tu seras mort. Tu as juste le temps d'activer le détonateur des bombes qui détruiront les rails sur lesquels, dans 5 minutes, passera un convoi avec 2000 prisonniers. Ton action peut leur sauver la vie. Même si tu ne la revois plus, sûr que l'idée de penser que Maria se trouve entre les prisonniers de ce train te donne des forces. Non, ça n'est pas ça, merde. Je crois que tu n'es pas sur le front. Non, bien sûr. C'est ta barque qui vient de sombrer, oui, c'est ça. Tu viens de faire naufrage et maintenant tu es entraîné par le fond. Tu pêchais à des heures indues afin de gagner plus d'argent pour les cadeaux de Noël de Lily. Tu étais seul et personne ne sait ce qui vient de t'arriver. Quand ta barque a coulé, un bout s'est accroché à ta cheville et t'a entraîné avec lui. Tes mains sont glacées et tu ne peux pas te détacher. Tu as bien essayé, mais c'est impossible. Tu commenceras à te sentir mal dans 33 secondes, à respirer de l'eau dans moins de 2 minutes et à alimenter les poissons d'ici 5 minutes environ. Ah, j'oubliais. Ta barque tombera dans un gouffre d'ici environ 1 minute. Si tu ne te détaches pas avant, tu seras mangé par des poissons abyssaux. Essaye de ne pas penser à Lily. Ça ne ferait que t'enrager. Non, tu es le soldat qui se vide de son sang et ne pourra pas activer le détonateur. Attends, oublie ce que je viens de dire. Tu es le marin qui coule sans rémission. Si tu es l'astronaute, tu n'arriveras pas à atteindre la capsule. Si tu es le soldat, tu n'arriveras pas au détonateur. Si tu es le marin, tu n'arriveras pas à la surface. Putain de merde! Non, je me trompe tout le temps. Ça n'est rien de tout ça. C'était simplement ton premier baiser.
Elle était si jolie que je n'osais l'aimer. Elle était si jolie, je ne peux l'oublier. Elle était trop jolie quand le vent l'emmenait. Elle fuyait ravie et le vent. Elle est bien trop jolie, et toi je te promets, l'aimer toute une vie, tu ne pourras jamais. Oui, mais elle est partie, c'est bête, mais c'est vrai, elle était si jolie. Je n'oublierai jamais.
Dès que tu retrouveras ton souffle, donne-lui un autre baiser.
C'est l'automne.
et je pleure souvent. Aujourd'hui c'est l'automne, qu'il est loin le printemps. Dans le parc où frissonnent les feuilles au vent mauvais, sa robe tourbillonne, puis elle disparaît. J'allie que je n'osais l'aimer. Elle était si jolie, je ne peux.